John, the vista here is unbelievable. What are we looking at here first?
Well, we're looking at the Uintas. We're in some of the higher Uinta Mountains in northern Utah. We're kind of at the western end of this range, and this is an unusual range in that it goes east and west. Mm. So it continues about 100 miles or more to the east of us.
Yeah, most of the ranges in the Rockies are all north and south.
That's right, yeah. So this is kind of an unusual one. It kind of sits right on the Wyoming-Utah border.
Right. Well, most people would say that God created the mountains in terms of in the beginning, right. God created the mountains, but that's not really true, is it?
I don't think so. I think these mountains that we're looking at actually rose at the end of the flood. So the earth was destroyed by the flood, and then as the flood ended, Psalm 104 tells us that the mountains rose up and the valleys sank down. I think these mountains that we see in Western North America and all the other high and rugged mountains that we see around the world rose up at the end of Noah's flood. That's why they're so high. They were never eroded by the flood. Other mountains that rose up earlier in the flood, like the Appalachian Mountains or the Atlas Mountains, were eroded down to the smaller mountains that we see today by the flood waters.
During the flood, we have those massive sedimentary layers that are being laid all over, like the Tapete Sandstone. You told me it just covered most of North America. Massive, massive. But they're horizontal, right?
They are.
Most all of those layers are horizontal. What happened then?
Well, we see some of the horizontal layers that are in these mountains towards the tops of these mountains. And these horizontal layers actually formed below sea level. So they formed during the flood, but they would have formed at depths that were much lower than we're 10,000 feet right now. And so they would have formed under the floodwaters. And then after the flood, they would have risen to the heights that they are now.
Was that a miraculous event, or can we see forces at play? That God, of course, was involved in that,
sure.
But what forces would move mountains this size?
Well, we think it goes back to our idea of catastrophic plate tectonics. And so as catastrophic plate tectonics started early on in the flood, it actually pulled continents down into the Earth's mantle. And those processes kept tugging on the lightweight continental material. But as those processes in the mantle of the Earth ended, it allowed the continents and the mountains to rise back up. And they rose back up because they're made of lightweight rock. It would be kind of like putting a bobber, mm-hmm. a fisherman's bobber, underwater, and then releasing it. It pops right back up to the surface and floats, you know, a bit above the water. And these mountains do the same thing.
So those layers were under a huge amount of tension and forces, and then they all began to come up, and that's where we get the Andes to these Uintas. Is that correct?
And as they rose up, in places there's faulted rocks, and other places the soft sediments have bent, because there's all those forces that are present there. And these mountains are probably going to rise up as giant plateaus. So don't think of the mountains rising up as we see them right here, but think of a lot more rock in between here as these mountains originally rose up.
Well, then what forces shaped them into the shape that we see today?
So there's a couple things that could do that. Number one, we don't think it stopped raining after the flood was over. We think it continued to rain. And if we have soft sediments that hadn't been turned into rock yet, they would probably be very susceptible to erosion.
So John, the massive rains that came, that's a result of the oceans being heated. And so now we have that, you know, massive amount of precipitation. Is that what you're talking about?
Yeah, when we have warm ocean water today, it happens in the United States, down in the Gulf of Mexico and the Atlantic Ocean. About August, September, the oceans really get warm and we have hurricanes. We have these big storms that generate, and oftentimes they go inland. I was just reading about one of these hurricanes that went up into Greenland and dumped 4 feet of snow from a hurricane, dumped all that snow in Greenland. And we think that something similar would have happened after the flood. We have big storms coming into the continents, and especially if you get those storms at high elevations like this, that water has a lot of energy as it runs downhill, many thousands of feet. Also at higher elevations like this, you have the opportunity for snow to fall. And if you have large amounts of snow that falls, you get the development of glacial ice.
Mm-hmm. And that glacial ice covered a lot of the northern part of North America then, did it not?
Yeah, it covered much of the Rockies. As you know, in Colorado, there's lots of glacial valleys there. There's still some small glaciers up in the Tetons and up into the Rocky Mountain National Park. And probably quite a few glaciers, small glaciers, here in the Uinta Mountains as well. And those glaciers are responsible for sculpting the shapes of these mountains. So we see, you know, mountain peaks and valleys and other types of things. Glaciers are one of the things that can carve those deep, steep-walled valleys mm-hmm. in various places. Of course, we don't see any glacial ice here.
Right.
It's not going to be long before there's snow here. Mm. But there's not enough snow here to generate glacial ice anymore.
Well, I guess the point, John, I hear you making is that even after the flood is over and Noah has landed in the ark, that there are a lot of catastrophic events that are going on all over, and that is what then shapes a lot of what we see.
You know, when Noah gets off the ark, it's not the end of catastrophe. To raise mountains up like this, you're going to have big earthquakes. And as these mountains rise, they're full of this wet, unconsolidated flood sediment, and you're going to get earthquakes. And when you have wet, unconsolidated sediment like that and earthquakes, that's a recipe for huge landslides. Some of the biggest landslides that we know about are here in the southern part of Utah. Those kinds of things happened in all of the mountain ranges around the earth as they were lifted up. And so those kinds of things, those kinds of catastrophes help shape, help sculpt the mountains that we see today.
Would it be safe to say then that what we see today, not just here, but all over the world, is not what Noah saw when he got off the mountain?
That's right. There's a lot of changes. When Noah got off the ark, we hadn't had any glaciers yet. Those were established maybe hundreds of years after he got off the ark. And so those things continue to shape things. We have a lot of volcanic activity that happened after the flood. Even here in the western part of the United States, in places like Yellowstone and places like the Green River Basin in Wyoming, we see volcanic ash beds. And there's no question that there is a volcanic ash catastrophe and eruptions and explosions in many different places. The northwest part of the United States is covered with lava beds. And there's no question that, you know, those kinds of things continued to happen after the flood was over.
Mm-hmm. And then when we add the thing that Dr. Austin and I were talking about, the massive amounts of water that were trapped afterwards, or the rain-filled basins, and those basins breached.
Yeah.
And then you have this massive erosion as well.
So we think something like that happened to carve Grand Canyon. But just a little bit further to the west of us is the Great Salt Lake. And the Great Salt Lake was another one of these big freshwater post-flood lakes. And that breached out to the north and ended up in the Snake River Valley and was responsible for carving much of that. All around the western part of the United States, we see these basins that accumulated in between these mountains. When you pop all these mountains up, and you have this basin in between, that's where rainwater and glacial ice melt is going to accumulate. And so there's evidence in the west here of giant freshwater lakes.
Yeah. We've had some major forest fires recently, and one of the catastrophes that happens after that is when it rains, there is a lot of erosion that occurs, but that's just from a what you would say probably is a very small rain shower compared to what was happening after the flood.
This happens in California, too, after all the fires they have. When they get the winter rains that come, there's no grass, there's no vegetation to hold down all that soil. And, you know, all that just mixes with mud. And so, you know, you have fire season and you run right into mud flow season in California.
And then I guess if you compound all that by the state of the earth in post-flood, the ground is soft and saturated.
That's right.
And so that erosion would even be more profound, I guess.
Yeah, Dr. Austin thinks the same way. He sees the number of catastrophes, the number of energy available for geological work and so forth, at kind of at a peak at the end of the flood and then tapering off until today's rates. So volcanic activity, earthquakes, massive landslides, and things like that were probably at their height at the end of the flood as these mountains were being lifted up. And those things have gradually tapered off to the rates that we see them today.
So the earthquakes we see today and the volcanoes and the hurricanes are nothing compared to those
probably minuscule
catastrophic events.
Yeah, probably minuscule.
Well, all of those forces, though, in the end, it reminds me that God makes even his judgment beautiful. And we can gaze at it in awe.
Yeah.